Hello, I'm Jason Solomons. Welcome to Seen Any Good Films Lately, the podcast with all the film recommendations, the personalities behind them, and the movies that move them.
I sat there afterwards and I thought, I'm not sure I could have directed that like that. It was so simple and so exquisitely made and so subtle and had such very profound things to say about female friendship.
Romola Garai is my guest today. She's been in Atonement, I Capture the Castle, Suffragette, and on TV in The Hour and The Miniaturist, just to name a few. And now she's made her feature directing debut with horror film Amulet. We talked to Romola about making the movie and the movies that inspired her to do so. We've also got world-renowned artists on the podcast, Joana, Hadjithomas and Khalil Joreige, with their beautiful film Memory Box, opening up all the emotions of a youth spent under bombardment in Beirut while listening to Blondie. And of course, I'll tell you if I've seen any good films lately. Let's get right into the first review, and that's of Nightmare Alley, the latest from Guillermo del Toro, whose last film, the monster B-movie pastiche The Shape of Water, somehow won him the Oscar for Best Picture. For me, anyway, this film is much better. It's pastiche again, yes, but it's of one of my favourite genres, film noir. Starring Bradley Cooper as a grifter who learns his con tricks at the circus before attempting to scam a Chicago tycoon with the help of a platinum blonde psychiatrist, a femme fatale played by Cate Blanchett, channeling Lauren Bacall, Veronica Lake, Barbara Stanwyck, and all.
Doctor.
Mr. Carla. What's that?
Your half. That's split, 50-50.
Not interested. I got what I wanted.
But you should have seen him. My God. Well, I think they'll be talking about that the rest of his life. I think every time they tell it, it'll just get better and better, bigger and bigger.
Toast, then, to your success.
He asked me to see one of his friends.
Who might that be?
He didn't say, but I'm considering it. I'll tell you what, you got a safe?
I do.
Why don't you keep this for me? I don't want Molly to know about it anyway. Why don't you keep it for a few days? If you change your mind, we'll split it 50-50. And if not, I'll keep it.
I liked it. Nightmare Alley is a good film. Stylishly done, great production design, lovely costumes. The script is nicely constructed too, even if the setup's a little slow to get going. But something does fail to spark it into greatness. I'm not sure I felt any sexiness between Bradley Cooper's relationships with either Rooney Mara or Cate Blanchett. I mean, it looked great, but it didn't really match up to the best of the noirs in emotional terms. It didn't leave me distraught at the hardness of heart, or dry-mouthed at the temptations of the femme fatale, or wincing at the acidity of the dialogue. But it's certainly worth watching, because greed, lust, betrayal, sex, they're always great ingredients at the movies. Now, Memory Box is a lovely new film from artists and directors Joana Hadjithoma and Khalil Joreige. They're originally from Lebanon, but now resident in Paris. The film's about a teenager in Montreal whose mother receives a box in the post on Christmas Eve, which the mum doesn't want to open for fear of the memories it holds. The daughter, nevertheless, sneaks in and delves in and sifts through her mum's diaries and cassette tapes that she finds in there, and transports this girl and us back to the 1980s, to Beirut, to growing up in the bombardment of the Civil War, with all its teenage friendships, heartaches, loves and losses. I asked the filmmakers if this gorgeous movie was different to their other works because of it being so personal.
It is different because, of course, there's two things. First, because of the subject, it's a film that is based on notebooks, tapes, and letters that I sent to my best friend in the 80s. So, of course, you can see those in the film. So, even if the film is not autobiographical, it's a fiction, but it is based on those notebooks that we adapted with pictures and images that Khalil took during the war at the same time in the 80s.
I also wanted to know how their relationship began, Joana and Khalil, if they knew each other back when these diaries were being written.
Yes, yeah. And he is present in my notebooks. I didn't really like him, but we met in the village that you see in the film. And this is why we really wanted to shoot there, in this village where we met first and disliked each other a lot. Ah, and then little
for
by
a long
little,
period.
For a long moment. Long, like some years, and then met again.
Did you?
So it was also for us really funny to reconnect with that.
So when you opened your notebook and there were some things, you say, oh, I love this guy, or he was cool and she was lovely and I had nice time. And then I see this, oh, Khalil, oh my God, he's so awful, he's so boring. Were there some things in the pages that you had?
Yeah, with nicknames funny. And things like this.
And so I, of course, we had forgotten a bit about exactly what I was writing. So it was a lot of fun.
We also discussed the continual renewal of building and memories that are necessary in Beirut. We talked about cinema they support there and the triggering power of music and food.
We shot the film in 2019 and started to edit the material in the fall, where at the moment where Beirut was going under a terrible economic collapse. And so it was really very strange and very emotionally difficult, because we wanted to do this film as a transmission from our past to our daughter, to reactivate the past in the present. But we didn't expect it to be so reactivated in a way, because there's a lot of echoes with the sentences that are really taken from my notebooks, where I talk about the devaluation of the money of and the exile and all this. And it was very sad to have those echoes. And in the same time, the last scene of the film is shot in a place that has been totally destroyed after the blast.
Wow. So it's being rebuilt. It's going to obviously, hopefully, be rebuilt again. See, we do this. Yeah. See, memory is in the buildings. Obviously, in Beirut, you have...
Yeah, but when if you go today to Beirut, you will say exactly what she said, meaning everything has been rebuilt, or at least in facade. Like we rebuilt our house.
Yeah.
The studio is too destroyed, so we have to move to another one in the same district.
But do you
and Vanna was really at 300 meters from the explosion in a cafe, and she...
But you see, you have this impression that it's always about cycles of destruction and reconstruction, yeah, of disaster and regeneration. And this is how we wanted to end the film, because it's very difficult to have all this despair. Mm. You know, we were so desperate that we felt that we just can't end like this. We have to find a way to say that... there will be light, like the song would say in the film.
Mm.
But don't you find memory is in the streets? Here in London, we have memory in every street corner on the old neighbourhoods, but then we have the new buildings coming up to replace them. But memory's still there. And you have the same in Paris, I'm sure. Some
yeah, but you know, memory doesn't need always a materiality. You have a lot of things that will go through storytelling, for example, through even sometimes you don't understand from where you remember these things. But what is great with document is that sometimes it surprises you, because it comes and, okay, I always have difficulty to say this word.
Serendipity.
Serendipity, c'est un très bon mot. It's a very nice word.
Yeah,
I don't know what it is.
Serendipity are nice encounters. It's eruption in the reed that surprise you and suddenly open a lot of possibilities.
Mm.
This serendipity is about is the documents, the archives, yes, are full of that.
Yeah.
But also, you know, in Lebanon, and I think in many, many countries, the problem is not about memory. It's about traces and history. Like what you do with traces, and what kind of history would you share as a community, sometimes as a family?
Mm.
Like what is the history that you will remember that will become the official history? And sometimes you have to deconstruct this history to be able to exist and live as a subject, as a person today,
yeah,
in your present.
I think cinema is obviously going to be a big collective history one day when they keep finding old films, or they have the digital memories of them. And you talk about cinema in your film. They go to see, as we mentioned, the Phantom of the Paradise. Yeah. Have you got a favorite? Is that your cinema in Beirut? What's your favorite cinema?
We were helping to run a cinema called Metropolis. That is a two-screen cinema that is really a great place to see films and retrospective, but had to close after the collapse and the explosion. The blast destroyed part of it.
Oh, no.
But we had to close before, but we are reopening a place, and Metropolis is really like a kind of baby for us.
What was the song that was the key song for you? I mean, all your friends, you danced to Blondie, yes, one way or another. Was that the real song that was the real one that all your friends danced to?
There was many of them, but this one was one. Blondie was very important. All the new waves, also, you know, like in the film, even 30 years after, when the song started, we reunite and we dance, thinking that we are still really young and that we have a life in front of us.
I'm repeating the same choreography. So yes. This is why we quit breakdance.
You've got the moves, yeah, but now your back hurts if you try them.
Exactly. This is why breakdance is not something that we do.
But it's those things that spark memory, like songs and films. Food does it too. I think there's a scene, very little scene at the start, where the grandmother makes kibbeh.
Yeah.
Leaves.
Yes, the little vine, and those spark, you know.
And there is kibbeh, but you're right.
It's like the little madeleine, and I thought, they're like the little madeleine of our heritage.
Exactly. The film is filled with madeleines.
But the grandmother, because you are talking about this scene where they are cooking together.
Yes.
The same. They are seeing. One is talking in Arabic, the other one is answering in another language. Yes. They are not speaking anymore the same language, but they are able to communicate with different elements, among them the food, among them being together and exchanging with tactile, hectic things.
It's very central. Memory is something that is very central.
And the film, if it's also joyful, is because it is central. Meaning the archive are sensual. You want to touch them. You want to stay, to be surrounded by them.
I wish I could. I have some diaries, but I was never very good at art, so I can't fold them and put photos and cut.
And please leave us this pleasure, because we are also artists. So we mix these two practices: the one of the coming from the arts and the one from cinema.
If I was to come to your flat, which looks very nice in Paris, after to celebrate your film, would you cook me some Lebanese food? What would you cook?
No, Lebanese food.
Yeah, but
no, Lebanese, it's not food Lebanese
that
food
that you don't eat in the restaurants. Lebanese food that we eat home,
like, no, for example,
mloukhiye.
Yeah, or things with rice and.
But you know kibbeh,
no,
because
a lot of vegetables.
You were mentioning kibbeh. Yeah. There's thousands of ways to cook kibbeh and to mix it with different. Our specialty is kibbeh with eggplants.
Ooh, I have that.
And the rebremen, which is melis coming from grenade.
Oh.
And vinegar.
So very sweet.
But this is because it's coming from my family.
Yeah, but if you did give me a vine leaf, I know I would only take one at a time.
Because you are, you know how long, how difficult it is to do, so you appreciate one by one.
I shall appreciate, like I appreciate your film very much. Memory Box is well worth opening, and it does so in London and Paris this week, starting here in the UK, January the 21st. Talking of memoirs, Ken Branagh's Belfast is out now, a black and white homage to his own youth in the city, set during the escalating tensions of the summer of 1969, when troubles between Catholics and Protestants and the arrival of the British Army saw communities and childhoods split apart.
You're running around here like the man in the big picture, not paying your taxes and spending all our money on horses.
It's the building trade. I told you it doesn't work the normal way. I told you I had it covered.
I was the one who had it covered.
No, you had to spend 3 years of back tax
to keep you out of bloody jail. We're drowning in debt.
We're near done with the back tax. £10 a month for 3 bloody years. This is the time to think about making a new start.
I know nothing else but Belfast.
Exactly. There's a whole world out there. We can give these boys a better chance than we ever had. There's Commonwealth countries needing tradesmen. The government will give you assisted passage. We can get the whole family to the other side of the world for £10. We're living in a civil war. And I'm not here to protect my family.
It's a twinkling, heartwarming film, no doubt. It was the awards frontrunner, I'd say, although its sentimentality seems to be putting voters off in the final stretches. Although I'm feeling prizes will still come to Catriona Balfe, who plays the very beautiful Ma, and Ciarán Hinds, who plays the grandpa. Despite Judi Dench's accent, I actually liked the emotional wallow of all of this. When you deal with nostalgia, it seems to me, you want the softness of it. The child's eye innocence. Take the edges off, you know, what could have been a very hard-hearted look at the ravages of community and sort of tribal factions. So you want that, and you want the romanticism of the music of Van Morrison. If you want toughness, then see a film like 71 by Jan de Monge. But for memory and warmth, Belfast is all right. It's a love letter to a very poisonous time.
I dig it when your fancy dressed up in lace. I dig it when you have a smile on your face. This inspiration's got to be on the flow. These invitations got to see it and know. It's just warm love. It's just warm love.
Van Morrison and Warm Love from Belfast. Now to my main guest, Romola Garai, the actress who's turned director for her feature debut, Amulet. It's a horror story about an Eastern European migrant, an ex-soldier, played by Alex Setarianu from God's Own Country, who finds himself in London in a big spooky house doing renovations to it, having been rescued from a fire by a kindly seeming nun, played by Imelda Staunton. But as he falls for his new landlady in this house and her mysteriously addictive cooking, he discovers hairless bats in the plumbing, lumps of black mould in the walls, sinister insignia in the ceiling, all while guilt and flashbacks from his past are closing in. When I caught up with Romola Garai last week, she's known for period dramas like Atonement and Suffragette and Emma on TV or Glorious 39. And I asked her if she was surprised by the fact that for her debut as a director, she'd made a horror film such as Amulet.
I think it would have, it maybe would have surprised me if I was like 20 and they'd, but no, I mean, now, like, I think the thing is, it's maybe more surprising to other people, or maybe people who don't know me personally. Do you know what I mean? People are like, huh, well, you've never acted in a horror film. You know, that's not your genre. But, you know, the thing is, of course, like, I would have loved to have acted in a horror film. But, you know, as an actor, you get often get the career you get and you just roll with that. And so yeah, I mean, I guess it's a sort of maybe a strange kind of debut for me, but I think everybody who knows me is like, yeah, of course you did. Like,
is it because of what you're smuggling in? I don't know if smuggling is the right word, but you're smuggling in messages, things that you wanted to say within the genre. I mean, that's what genre's there for. It's to sort of,
I don't know that I smuggle them. They're sort of strapped to the to the front of the train, aren't they?
But I mean, but they are. I mean, because you say I've made a horror film, but people don't don't expect it to be about perhaps so feminist or perhaps so full of anger about certain issues. Or maybe they do. That's the bit of you that I expect rather than some yeah. that she's made a horror movie. So I suppose what we're saying is that that genre now is very expandable and you can kind of play within it and do what you want with it.
Yeah, and obviously there is the kind of, like, there is a, you know, tradition of kind of revenge fantasy and horror. That's like a well-trod path, and obviously, and then there's a subsection of that which is sort of feminist revenge, you know, rape revenge films. Like, that's obviously a very kind of long tradition, and, you know, the film kind of works within that, I suppose. I mean, it was a weird experience for me writing the film because it was the only time, like, I made my short, and then, you know, that kind of, like, I started to write features after that, but it was slightly, the whole process was slightly slowed up because I started a family at the same time. So, like, you know, it wasn't the kind of, you know, quick jump from short to feature anyway because of that. And then, you know, I think I basically started writing features that were just too expensive. I started to write features that were very much the kinds of films that I had acted in.
Yeah.
And they were like mid-budget British films. Now, that sort of budget range is a much smaller part of the industry now. You have to go lower or higher, you know. And after a few years of trying to develop, like, features that had a bigger budget than Amulet and not getting where I needed to get, somebody said to me, have you thought about writing a horror film? And, you know, you love horror, you like, you know, I enjoyed horror films. And so I kind of had a couple of weeks spare and I just thought, oh, I'll have a go, you know. And I did a sort of, it was sort of like free writing, you know, I didn't have a strong idea of what I was going to write, and this is what came out. So
it looks beautiful. There's some fantastic scenes in there that, you know, that are shocking and quite scary, and kind of like my fingers were like this. There's also a house in there that that creeps me out, you know. Scary houses are really good. I think they're a staple of horror, and I think we've all sort of bought one or lived in one or had building nightmares and scraped away things, and I think that appeals to many, many people. Where is this house? How did you find it? Were you actually in a real house?
Yeah, we were in a real house, except for the attic. So we had to build the attic because it wasn't big enough. But the house is in Battersea. It exists. It's there. I mean, literally two weeks away from our proposed start date. And we were very much at the point of having to shift the film, which, given the kind of film it was, might have meant that the film would collapse, you know, in the way that these things can be quite precarious. We had really struggled to find somewhere, because if you go on, like, location sites, you know, everything's been used or it's too big, you know. It's not like a mansion, as you say, like, the, you know, the trope, the sort of film trope is that it's like a big scary mansion, but this is just an ordinary, yeah, this is just an ordinary house, you know, on a London street. I was like, how hard can it be to find a derelict rundown house on an ordinary London street? But, you know, obviously people live in those houses and, you know, don't want to move in unless somebody make a horror film in them, for very good reasons. So we'd done all the things and we'd flyered streets and we'd tried every kind of possible avenue. But then this couple who'd bought a house but hadn't done any work to it yet, but were about to kind of gut it, let us go in and, like, go mad in there. But it was perfect because I think the things that I recognize about, like, you know, obviously being brought up in the UK, about there being, that everything's damp all the time, you know, there's just been black mold around all of the windows, the plumbing not working, the sinks and radiators making strange noises, like, all of those things were already there in this house. So, and there was Japanese knotweed in the garden, so we weren't allowed out into the garden, so it was already felt like the house was just kind of full of things attacking it. And it was great.
I love it. I hope they've done it up and now they've got, like, a million, as seen in,
yeah, Amulet. I think there's, like, a gym in there.
How did you find the process? You mentioned there about going too high and trying to get things made and then the industry not responding to it, not listening to it. What did you find the problems there were? And now that you've made this one, the cheap one, and people like it and it's coming out, you can kind of go, right, well, I can make a movie. What is the next step to kind of go, right, well, I've got these two mid-budget ones that I want to get done and people will listen to you? Is that how it works?
I think the only thing I've learnt at all in the sort of 10 years that I've been, since making my short to making my feature, obviously a couple of years eaten up with COVID, is that it is absolutely pointless to try and have any kind of plan, you know? Like, you have to produce as much work as you can and just throw it all at the wall and just, you know, maybe something will stick. Like every time I've gone, this will be my next film, you know, then people will go, no, it won't. You know what I mean? And you just take constant knocks and you have to just kind of constantly be reappraising and, you know, to stick all of your eggs in your one basket and say, this is the film that I'm going to make next. And I'm going to, like, I mean, certainly for me, it's just emotionally too hard as well, because then when people say no and people say no all the time, you just get constant no's all day, every day, weeks and weeks and weeks in and out. It's just too hard, you know? So I think for me, I just try to have a spread of different things all going, trying to come up with new ideas a lot and try to be fairly kind of fluid, because otherwise, because of the industry we have, because of where cinema is, because of COVID as well now, obviously as well, like, yeah, you just don't, you don't have the opportunity to say, and now I will make my 4-hour like film, you know, adaptation of To the Lighthouse, because, you know, people will be like, I'm not sure about that.
What have you been watching? Have you seen any good films lately?
Yeah, I have. Yeah, I was aware when we were sort of talking that the two films I saw recently that I've really loved are, I think, recent to streaming, but not like super recent, because I saw Lynn and Lucy.
Oh, yeah.
For the first
time. That's an interesting film.
I thought it was an absolutely incredible film. And I walked around our living room really angry for about an hour afterwards as to why it didn't win like all the prizes.
Yeah.
You know? I just thought it was utterly, utterly, utterly extraordinary. And I think it's not easy to make such a simple film so good. Do you know what I mean? Like, you know, I had things, I had scares, I had the option, you know what I mean? Like, this film is just about two women who are friends.
It's Nicola Burley and I can't remember, a girl that they found on the streetcar.
Yeah, and a non-actress, essentially, or it was certainly her first piece of acting. And,
yeah, she had answered an advert in the Dagenham Inquirer.
Yeah, answered an advert in the paper, yeah. And I just thought it absolutely blew me away. And I've been sort of boring everybody rigid about it.
A good shout, I've forgotten. I love a bit of slice of British social realism, I really do. And that has a little twist on it. And very good shout. It was a forgotten movie. It did a little bit of festival circuitry, but
I sat there afterwards and I thought, I'm not sure I could have directed that. Like, that, it was so simple and so exquisitely made and so subtle and had such very profound things to say about female friendship, yeah. Which, you know, sadly, you know, it still feels like, you know, that's something that people feel like, well, it's a woman should be, but it was a man who directed that film, and I thought it had some incredibly powerful things to say about women and their relationship.
Forgetting his name, unfortunately, but that's...
Yeah, he's really good.
And what was the other, you said you saw another thing?
Yeah, the other one was The Nest.
Oh, yeah, with Jude Law and Carrie.
Yeah, we were at Sundance with that film. But I think that film's release last year, I was away when it was out in cinemas. And then, so I just watched it for the first time last week. And it was, I thought, again, a really, really amazing film. For me there was a problem or something to be overcome, which is that you don't really like any of the people in the film initially, and so you sort of think, oh, this, the work of this film is that I'm going to be having to like this like rich stockbroker and his awful spoilt wife and their awful spoilt children. But like really quickly it just becomes about how awful it is to kind of move house.
There's a spooky house movie as well,
slightly. Spooky house, and you know, and also the money, like how money is just so corrosive of everything. Yeah. And I found it really powerful, actually, in a sort of like slightly like a Dickens, do you know what I mean, like in that it was sort of about the kind of corrosive power of money on the family unit, and I found it very profound. Yeah, and
Dickens is a really interesting little comparison, because it is that it's got that sort of that parvenu, that nouveau riche kind of arabesque thing going on. But I think Jude's always much better when you don't like the character.
Yeah, I'm afraid I feel exactly the same. I never believe him as a nice person. I've never met him. I don't know anything about him. I'm sure he's lovely. But like, I don't ever buy, I always just find him much more watchable, much more believable when he's playing these awful characters. And she is so extraordinary in it. And like, you know, Carrie Coon is obviously has a really long body of work, but like has really kind of, you know, is having a real moment in the last few years. But she has a scene in the film where he tries to order for her in a restaurant, which is maybe one of the, I mean, I don't laugh out that much when I'm watching anything really, even comedies, but like I really laughed out loud and started clapping my hands.
Has anyone tried to order for you?
I mean, if they did, I mean, just out of pure spite, I would, you know, refuse and I would order something I probably didn't want. Although actually, I mean, I'm so incredibly greedy that like anybody who knew me at all would know that I would eat anything. So if I would be like, well, I don't like celery, people would be like, well, that's not true.
Most expensive thing on the menu, just always do that. Yeah. That'll piss them off. Lobster spaghetti or something like that.
Yeah.
Quick fire. What's the first film you ever saw at the cinema, Romola Garai?
The first film I ever remember seeing was Disney's Pocahontas.
Oh, that explains you.
And I cried and cried and cried.
Where would that have been?
It would have been in the little local cinema, which is sadly no longer there, in a town of Chippenham in Wiltshire.
Oh, it's not there.
No. Hmm. Yeah, sad. Yeah, it was a just two-screen little old, you know.
But Pocahontas, and there she was, yeah. Feisty female heroine. I think.
Yeah, feisty female heroine at one with nature and, like ganging up against the men with an army of raccoons by her side. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that does explain you a lot. What film changed your life? And it could either be one that you were in or one that you saw and it just had an impact.
I think I would probably say Cachet, the Haneke film, because I think my parents were very sort of quite puritanical about art, and they were constantly, we didn't really have a television, we weren't really allowed to watch things. And then when I was a teenager, I kind of went right the other way and only ever wanted to watch Speed and like, you know, like blockbusters. And I'd watched it with my brother and we watched like Total Recall, and you know, I went the other way. I really rejected a lot
Speed
of that.
Speed is very pure cinema, I have to say. Yeah, just sort of as a request to your dad.
But like I really, really went very much the other way, because I found the kind of overbearing effort to kind of fill us full of culture as children, I found quite like I got exhausted by
I'm a
that.
Bit remiss now, I'm feeling bad, I should be forcing it down my children.
No, well this is the point, like don't do that, because I think it's counterproductive. So then I think I was about sort of 23 when that movie came out, 24, and that is obviously like I think one of the greatest films ever made, and I was completely changed by it. And I sort of had a real understanding that like I suppose that the effort to try and create something that's really confronting for the audience, that is not convenient for them, that they're not going to be allowed to go home and feel good about themselves, that they're going to be forced to ask questions about their kind of purest lies and deceits and the sort of failure of human beings to kind of be their best selves is an important thing for filmmakers to do. So yeah, that film had a really big impact.
I think it's
it.
One of the great films of this 21st century.
I think it's almost untouchable. And you know, and obviously that scene where, you know, he slits his throat and you sort of feel all of the awful horror of colonialism and racism and everything that did, like that for me was like, this is what cinema is for, you know, that it can take an image, a moment, and describe this whole history of human experience behind it.
When I was at the premiere of that in Cannes, the first screening of that, so no one knew what was going to happen, and that happened. And it's still the most shocking moment I've ever felt in a room. The whole audience, some gasped, some cried, some were shocked. I could feel it. The knife almost cut everyone's throat at the same time in there. And it was just such a piercing kind of gesture. Great choice. What films did you watch for inspiration for Amulet?
So the big one that I thought about a lot when I was going into it was The Tenant, because that's also one of my favorite films.
The Tenant,
yeah, Polanski, yeah. So I think I went in thinking a lot about films that I liked that were very much about a kind of individual's fractured identity and also about their relationship with their environment, you know. So that's obviously something that was a big kind of, that was the thing that I was thinking about at the beginning as well. And also not really a horror film, but I really love Pan's Labyrinth. That's one of my favorite films, and Pan's Labyrinth offers a kind of karmic resolution at the end of the film, which is something that I found very affecting when I saw it, very moving, and I want to sort of emulate some of that. Also creatures, you know, I love creatures in films, so that I think was kind of in my mind
in this one. Yeah,
yeah. And then when we started storyboarding and kind of talking about it, we ended up like looking at two European horror films, Trouble Every Day and Zalowski's Possession as well, as a way of kind of finding a narrative. Oh, and Hellraiser as well, as a way of kind of finding a kind of visual narrative for something that feels very, well, in the example of Hellraiser, very British, and in those other films, kind of quite European, you know. So there is the sense of the kind of dampness and the coldness, and not the richness, the saturation that you get more with Hollywood horror films, you know, that this feels kind of more dull and kind of slimy.
Great choices. Did you have a film poster on your wall when you were a kid or a teenager?
When I was a teenager, I did, but it was like, I was very, very obsessed with Keanu Reeves. So this was in my hyper kind of like, I was really into blockbusters. So, you know, I had like two like massive naked like pictures of like Keanu Reeves. And maybe
Where'd
I
you
had
get naked pictures of Keanu Reeves.
Well, he was topless. He was topless. But I remember my dad objecting, which was hilarious, like saying that this is, you know, inappropriate, but like really huge. And that would have been Speed, Point Break, Meet Joe Black, you know, around those sorts of like peak Keanu. That was my sort of, those were my posters. Yeah.
Oh, what about now?
Do I have, I mean, Sam won't let me keep the Keanu posters up in my room now. He says I am not allowed them. Yeah. I've only ever bought one original sort of film poster, and that was of The Graduate, which is what also one of my favorite films, which I really, really love. But I think after Me Too, I took it down. I just sort of thought, I don't want to look at it. Like it was a picture of Anne Bancroft, and it, you know, she's kind of smoking. There's something about the film's relationship with women and their sexuality, and that, I don't know. I always thought
she was held up as a woman with agency. So
she does have agency in the film, but I sort of feel like she's bested by the film, isn't she? Kind of humiliated,
yes,
by the film.
I think,
and the shots of her at the end where she's like, ah!
I think she's punished, you know, for her sexuality, isn't she?
Yeah, yeah. So yeah. I took it down, and yeah, it's in the attic now, I think.
Okay, Catherine.
Punishing me from the attic.
Have you ever fallen in love at the movies?
Well, I mean, there's Keanu, of course. Mm-hmm. Like, if that could be called love.
It's
but
definitely
really,
love. Yeah.
It definitely wasn't love. Yeah, I mean, I have definitely had film experiences watching films with people where I've understood in the course of the film, like watching the film, that they were somebody that I could love. Yeah. But I suppose, I guess maybe I would say that I probably had the reverse more, where you're in a movie with someone and they don't get it, and you're like, I went on a date to see Muriel's Wedding once with somebody, and they didn't laugh once, like in the whole film. And I just literally walked out of the cinema and was like, oh, my leg hurts. I think it's falling off. I've got to go.
You're terrible, yeah. You said.
You're terrible, exactly. Yeah.
What's your favourite screen musical moment? Can be a dance number from a musical, or it can be just be the use of music to illustrate a scene.
That is such a good question. I think I would probably say it's the music in Under the Skin, Jonathan Glazer's Under the Skin.
Mika Levy's music, yeah. All the way through that. I can hear it.
Yeah, it changed things, didn't it? It changed things, and it spawned a million like imitations, hasn't it? But I had never heard a score like that, you know. I mean, I have lots of favorite soundtracks, you know, in The Mood for Love, and you know, with amazing, you know, the piano. And I think for me that the way that was kind of reduced to its absolute like minimalist nothingness, and the impact that had on the screen. And actually, I have to say, like, I've never watched Under the Skin with the music off, but I don't know if the film would work without
it. Well, it's a character, isn't it? It's just a
character. I mean, it's almost the most important thing about the film. You know, I mean, I love the film. I think it's extraordinary, but I think the music is doing 70% of the work. And so I suppose I feel like it's really significant.
Very good choice. Two quick ones. If I could transport you through time and you could visit a set of a film being made anywhere in the world, what set would you go to? Or maybe what scene would you go to?
I think I would be very intrigued to kind of, I mean, well, this is probably quite a boring answer, but A Clockwork Orange is one of my favourite films.
It's not boring, it'd be amazing to be there.
Yeah, and I think I would love to stand there and watch Kubrick direct that film, and to have, and I suppose to wonder what it felt like, because I feel like that film, maybe more than any other film I've ever seen, is like the perfect imagining of somebody's subconscious, of their like interiority outwards, you know. And when you do that, you have to, like, you know, I've now made a film, for a small film, but like, you know, you have to make every single person, like, you know, come together to kind of realize your subconscious, you know, and the effort of will, the strength of character, the kind of ego that it takes to make that happen is something I hadn't quite appreciated before. And I think, and I appreciate that. I mean, I appreciate it in terms of it being a compliment. And I would love to see somebody just like make a piece of work that felt so extraordinarily kind of horrific and extreme, and make everybody go do that and go along with that, and yeah, and just the kind of pure unadulterated creativity of that film.
Yeah, there's a Kubrick lurking in you, I can see. Maybe there. Finally, what's your favorite cinema? Where's your favorite
cinema to go to? Yeah. And these days it's the Picture House Central.
It's a good place. Is Amulet playing there?
Yes, it is. We have a preview screening on Friday. Yeah. Very exciting.
Well, that's great when it's your favorite. What's the best one you've ever been in, like a cinema?
Oh, the best cinema I've ever been to is in San Sebastian. It's right. Have you been there?
Yeah. Not the new one.
Not the new one. Yeah, that's so beautiful.
Isn't it? I love that place.
Yeah.
On the street with all the sort of tapas bars around it.
It's old school. It's really cinema. Beautiful. Yeah. I was in a film that played there, and it was an amazing experience.
Which
Such
one?
A beautiful place. It was called Earwig. It's the Lucille Hadzihalilovic, most recent Lucille Hadzihalilovic film.
It's coming out, we hope it's coming out soon.
Yeah, I hope so. Yeah, because it was in the London Film Festival just before Christmas. So hopefully, yeah, be released quite soon.
So we can see you in Earwig, and we can see your actual subconscious live on screen at Amulet in Picture House Central.
For anybody who needs to see my subconscious, it's now available to view. Yeah.
Well, listen, lovely to speak to you, obviously.
Yeah, nice to speak to you, man. Take care.
Lots
see
love.
You soon.
Bye.
Bye.
And Romola Garai's Amulet is out in previews all week and on nationwide UK release from January the 28th. And that's it for this week. I'll be back on the awards season trail next week. Be talking to the BAFTA longlisted director Sonita Gale about her very powerful documentary Hostile, which looks at the government's hostile environment policy, the heartache it's causing and why. And in the tonal shift of the year, I'll have the wonderful Garth Jennings on talking about his spectacular new animation, Sing 2. Thanks to my guests from this week, Joana Hadjithomas and Khalil Joreige, and to Romola Garai, and to editor Kate Dawkins, as ever. If you want to come and say hello, by the way, I'll be hosting Q&As at Finsbury Park Picture House on Friday, January the 21st, and at the Rio in Dalston on January the 23rd for the film Hostile. So we'll have some serious discussions down there. So do come along, watch the doc, ask some questions, and if not, I'll see you next week. And we'll play out with a gorgeous ode from the end of Guillermo del Toro's Nightmare Alley. It's not all hard of heart when you can hear Stardust by Hoagie Carmichael. See ya.
Though I dream in vain, in my heart it will remain my stardust melody, the memory of love. Refrain.